Welcome to Paul Taggart's Elphen Chronicles and this free-to-view bonus feature in which we share with you a snapshot of the extraordinary work that has gone into the making of my Elphen Chronicles waistcoat. We invite you to join us on our journey through this beautiful part of the world as we make our way to the workshop of textile artist Ruth Black. Step along with us into Ruth's weaving shed and workshop as Eileen and I get to see for the first time how Ruth intended to bring our collective ideas to life. So this had to be totally dismantled to bring it down from Harris, didn't it?
Yeah.
So that must have taken some deconstruction and reconstruction.
We minimized the deconstruction so that it was really, you know, basically we only took off the bits that joined that side to that side. This side came as a whole, that side came as a whole. And it all went back together remarkably smoothly. The one place that you mustn't stand is exactly where you're standing.
Yes, I'll stand well over here, away
you
from
can,
the shuttle.
You can come to this side and
all
stand
right.
behind
the side of the shuttle, yes.
But it's just that the shuttle
it can come off at any angle.
Sharp,
I know.
It could come flying.
After a day of that, you don't need to go jogging, do you, really?
It beats going to the gym any day. Let me put in a different colour and you'll see how it can kind of totally change the look of the pattern.
Very subtle colour mixing this.
Yes. I'm just...
There's a demonstration of complementary colour mixing. There it is, green and red.
Mm-hmm.
Look at that.
No.
You need some patience to do this, though, don't you? I mean, the complexity of that is just amazing.
And it must remind you of the old mills that you worked
it
in the
does,
first year out of college.
Oh, I'd forgotten
well,
it.
Used to take days to set these
and
things.
Those are the old mills.
Really wide ones, too, you know.
Yes.
Like three times this width and...
Yes, I mean,
this is
just 696 ends, so it's not too bad. It takes me about 3 hours to tie in a warp.
Ruth, is this one of your original patterns that's on?
Yes, this is a random herringbone. When I started weaving Harris Tweed, I thought, there's no point in me spending time weaving something that I could walk into the mill shop and buy.
Uh-huh.
I wanted things that were different, interesting.
Unique to yourself.
And also, mostly what I'm weaving are 2 meter lengths with fringed edges,
mm-hmm.
fringed ends. So I'll weave 2 meters and then wind it on so that I've still got this warp.
Yeah.
The warp there. And I'm just going to tie that because at this stage I'm not trying to make a neat cloth, otherwise I would have threaded that through in the right pattern.
Yeah.
But if you're going to have this fringe on a garment,
mm-hmm.
you could have a very pretty tweed here that was a mix of contrasting warp and weft, but then the fringe is totally plain mm-hmm. if it was all one colour.
Yeah.
So if you look at what I've got on the warping bank there, you'll see I've got several different shades of blue, from a light blue through to a navy. several shades in between.
Yeah.
And it means that the fringe, it's going to read as blue for the woven part of it.
Yeah.
But the fringe is going to have some interest in it rather than just be a single colour. Right. I'm going to untwist some at the back here. And generally by the time you get to the end of a warp, you are getting these twists.
Yes.
You know, most of the weaving is plain sailing and you're not having to do this, but this is just, I mean, to be honest, I could cut this off at any stage. But I knew I wasn't going to have it cut off and re-threaded in time for you coming.
Okay.
So I thought I'll leave a bit on so that you can actually see.
But all thread does is when you're knitting, I mean, a bit towards the end, the skein is starting to twist in on itself, which is the same principle, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes.
Yeah.
When you put the warp on, you're basically doing it in bundles of 12 threads coming through this rattle.
Uh-huh.
And you've got them, I'll show you up here, this crisscross bit, they're going one, crossing over. But down here, at this end, it's bundles of 12. And it's the bundles of 12 that come through here. So you've got your 1-1 crossover.
Yeah. Mm.
For tying it in so that the threads are all in sequence. But the bundle here, like this, is twisted because it just twists naturally.
Yeah.
It twists naturally because we're working with singles yarn, which has no ply in it. So it's been spun, but it's not been plied.
So it's plying itself.
So it's plying itself. It's trying to ply itself, yes.
It's like painting in a way. It's understanding the nature of the medium and then getting the best out of it. So
and
you're working with them.
There are advantages and disadvantages to working with wool. The disadvantage is that it's quite sticky. The fibres on it catch from one strand to the next. And so there is this tendency for them all to catch on each other, whereas if you had something like cotton or linen or silk, it would be smooth and pull through. Yeah. On the other hand, the advantage of it is that wool is a terribly forgiving fibre with quite a lot of natural inbuilt elasticity in it, and it will allow you to do quite a lot of pulling it about, and give me another 10 centimetres or so before I change. But you can see how the pattern is totally different.
Mm. Oh, it's complementary colours. Kind
with,
of mixing
with,
do, for, yeah.
with the green oh, as against the grey.
Yeah.
And in fact, let's just do it now. If I take that out and put something with very little contrast in it. I haven't got a red bobbin, but I've got a dark brown one here. I'll put this in.
It's interesting because it's visual colour mixing, because it's like pointillism. You're getting these tiny points next to one another.
Yeah.
And they're...
This is very much visual.
See is the pattern's almost completely disappeared, and what you're seeing is the stripy warp.
Fascinating, isn't it?
You get completely different effects. So when I set up a 50 meter warp, that was going to be 54 meters, of which about 52 will be usable,
right?
And that 52 meters, and I'm working 2 meter length so that I can use it to make my wraps and my capes and things like that, scarves. So I'll get 25, 26 lengths out of that 50 odd metres.
And a lot of exercise.
And a lot of exercise, yes. The plan is...
Handmade by artists in the Highlands of Scotland, the process originally started many months earlier with our first visit and further discussions during a follow-up meeting in which our partner and design director, Sunita Gahir, set out her vision for this unique waistcoat. You will come to appreciate that this is painting with thread as you watch Ruth explain her creative interpretation of my original artworks. Welcome to my studio in the Highlands of Scotland, from where we bring you Paul Taggart's Elphen Chronicles. As a young child, I was a very solitary individual. I loved to play on my own, especially in my grandmother's garden. Part of the garden was cultivated, but the most of it was wild. And I loved walking through the long grasses and weeds and flowers that grew there. I remember those summer days, chasing butterflies and searching for insects and frogs under stones and logs. At the bottom of this garden, the very bottom of the garden, there was a small rise. And once I was beyond this small rise, I was hidden from my grandmother back in the house. Just at the bottom of the rise, was a small area of different grasses. The large grasses diminished, and here was a swathe of fine green grass, and it grew in a perfect circle. And I remember one day, with the sun on my eyelids, as I sat on that rise, looking down on that grassy area, just closing my eyes for a moment and reopening them, there was a movement. And I recognised it as a blue butterfly. I know there are blue butterflies everywhere, but there weren't any in my grandmother's garden. I knew that because I'd chased many a butterfly. There were cabbage whites, there were tortoiseshells, red admirals, but I'd never seen a blue one there. So I was fascinated by it, but as I tried to focus my eyes on it, it disappeared. So I closed my eyes again and opened them just slightly, and the blue butterfly came back. And I thought this was incredibly strange. So I kept my eyes half closed, pretending I was asleep. And I watched this butterfly flutter around, and it was soon joined by another, and then another. And they began to fly in a circle, a clockwise circle around this green swathe of grass. You may say, well, you're probably asleep. I had, after all, closed my eyes. But this was not the only occasion it happened. After that time, I went down to that spot again and again throughout the summer, and the blue butterflies came back. And soon I became absolutely entranced by their magic. As an adult, I always wanted to capture the essence of this magic, which is how, in the mid-90s, I found myself bringing to life the mysterious creatures that are the elfin. During the light of day, I would take up my brush and watercolour paints to work on a set of 18 unique illustrations that were enchanting me. As I painted, I became so engrossed that all other paintings and books were forsaken in order to free my imagination and allow me to concentrate on completing my first book in the Elphen Chronicles, in which I recount a particular legend involving the elfin swarm leader Lacewing, and an itinerant artist by the name of Artemis Glynn. However, it had always been my hope to set aside enough time to work on a collection of oil paintings with which to depict another significant event in Elfin history.
I have cut out your waistcoat, but it's just the pieces.
Lovely. Elfin blue.
That's the colour you chose. Yes.
Oh, gorgeous.
This is the lining.
Ah,
that's really nice, wow. Isn't it?
Which I think they've made a lovely job of.
Yeah.
Now, you won't actually see the lining on the waistcoat unless you open up the waistcoat, because there will be a facing down. There's the facing down, the for the inside. Back.
Right.
So round the neck and round the armholes, mm-hmm. and down the front, there will be a facing.
Right.
And it'll be interfaced to make it a reasonably substantial, mm-hmm. not heavy.
Yeah.
But it's... Those two
colours actually go very well together.
Well, you chose them.
So oh, right. No wonder they go well together.
And that's the gold for doing the slipcover for the book.
Oh, that's nice.
Oh, that is a beautiful.
That really is a gold, isn't it?
That will be on the outside with the lining on the inside.
Yeah.
Let's see them against each other, Ruth. Oh, look
wow.
at that.
Oh, they really suit, don't they?
Look at that on the monitor.
Yes, that looks wonderful.
Look at that, yeah. Ruth. Isn't that fab?
Yeah, no,
oh,
that's really...
Oh, that's exciting. Look at those.
Yeah.
So those are the goals.
Sunita should be well pleased with those.
I love the lining.
Don't she?
Yeah.
I'm pleased with the lining.
Yeah, it's very nice.
I have done sample stitch out. This is what Sunita wanted to go on the back of the waistcoat up here.
It needs colour in the bodies, doesn't it? Because they look.
The only thing you have to worry about is if they look as if they don't have any clothes on at all, which would be a slight worry.
So we possibly need to.
We can. I mean, all this is up for grabs. I was testing the stitch pattern rather than the thread colours. I particularly like this variegated thread.
It shows the cells up, doesn't it?
That
it shows
really
the cells very well.
One.
Whereas this
that's tends quite to get, flat.
Yeah, tries to get a
but it's not really possible. You can either have both of the wings in this one.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or I could add in some veining.
Oh, that would be nice.
And that actually would then work, that would work across the bodies as well, wouldn't it?
You know, so you would have just a fine row of stitching, this thickness here.
Yes.
So that could be done just as a running stitch.
That would be
very nice.
But I don't think it's needed on this one.
No.
But I think if we put it on this one, that would just... Lift
it a little bit. Because you can actually, on the monitor here, you can actually see the veins.
Actually, the bodies, I tried to do the folds.
Yes.
That you could see on your painting.
It's very difficult because they're semi-transparent, which is a very difficult thing to...
This is a challenge.
And the scale, because she said she wanted it just 10 centimetres across.
Yeah.
The only thing I would miss one is I wonder whether that line work there could be taken across the leg so that we... Because it looks as if her legs are bare right to the top there. I'm just wondering whether we could, as we have lost it there, really, whether you could lose that little bit.
They need a darker patterning on them, just to emphasise it. But I think the way you've got those trails underneath the wings.
I think that's superb. I think all of it is. In fact, I like this one as it is.
It's quite difficult to see. But what we could do, which would probably help, would be if we used more than one colour of thread.
Oh, I see what you mean.
If you give them a self-coloured skin, in a sense, that would overcome a lot of that, I think.
Can we go to the computer and ask?
You can indeed.
I had it there showing. How the stitching
how the
should look.
Work. How would, yes.
But to edit it, it's much easier
if I do it like that.
Yes.
Is it possible to bring up the original file on there alongside that at all?
I can. Yeah. If I open.
Right.
So you've got the colour is shading there. You've got at the top it's yellow and then it goes down to a pinky colour.
I can see exactly why you've done that on this side. The lines across these are like tattoos, if you like. They're directly on the skin. And then the other lines are supposedly the garment, if you like, that's falling down. So that should, in a way, I can see, you see, I've exposed the whole leg there. I think if you take just one or two of those across there.
So these bits, you're saying that if I take some of those lines down like
this one's fine actually, because you've taken the lines across there, which is fine. I mean, they could come further across, because those are lines around the leg. So in fact, those lines would continue through and they would flow into the garment, if you like. But these are the tattoo marks on the leg itself. So those could be taken across. It's the other one, really, mainly, I think, because of the way that I've drawn it.
That these bits...
These could be taken right across,
Should be coming across almost like that.
Yes. They sort of swoop down into the, as you've actually got them there, haven't you? You've got those coming across, so they should be, they're a continuation of that, really.
So this bit, if I bring that there,
that's perfect. Apart from not going across
but
the arm,
but not going across the arm. Yeah. But
that's it. But you've got it.
I can play around.
You've got
with that.
Absolutely. And, that's
and,
it.
And the same with the other. If we go to the other side.
Yeah.
I've got another thought for the body. If you look at the original file, it's just another way of looking at it. The body of the elfin on the right, if you use the same threading as you did for the wings of the elfin on the left, and then use the threading from the right wing onto the left body.
That's easy enough to change.
And that would get us over that hump of them.
I think that would make the difference.
Yes, yeah. I think it
and
would.
The way you've got those trails under the wings is spectacular. I mean, you wouldn't expect to see that fine.
I think to
work,
create all of that fabulous. In stitching is tremendous.
It is.
Interpreting
it's quite
it.
Fun.
Painting with thread.
Yeah, it is. I mean, there are limitations on what you can achieve.
Absolutely. Of course.
You can't achieve at that scale with embroidery thread what you can achieve on a big oil canvas. You know, they're different mediums, you get different effects.
Absolutely.
But I'm happy with it in a particular...
But you're working with a medium again, and you're getting the maximum out of that medium, and that's the...
The other thing you ought to understand is the original for this is not an oil, it's a watercolour.
Yeah. It is, yes. Yeah.
So even when you get a watercolour up on screen, Ruth, the computer screen, because of the nature of the way it works, will bleed through that watercolour anyway.
Yeah.
You know, and cameras can't capture.
It's hard to interpret a line and wash, though, because a line and wash painting is a simplification.
Yes.
Of an object or whatever,
oil's
and you have to read a lot into that. And so, to translate that into another medium, which is not line and wash, is very very difficult.
Phenomenal.
And I think you've done a fantastic
job. Absolutely phenomenal. What I think is astonishing is that you're prepared to go through all this trouble, of trial and error as well, to get to it, which is.
So that's the shape of the waistcoat. And then the idea is to have the wings going from here to here, across that buttonhole, which is kind of your waist height.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I dyed and I deliberately crushed silk. I don't know if you can see. It's a silk with a lurex. Thread
oh my
in
goodness,
it.
Look at
so
that.
It shimmers.
Do you see that?
Yeah.
So it's got a shimmer too. I thought that was going to. I know you didn't want anything shiny.
No, but shimmer's different.
But shimmer's different. and elfin wings, I feel they need to shimmer.
That's like the stuff of which the garment's made. I mean, that's really right. Just like the cobwebs.
Oh, I love that. Isn't that amazing?
You gave me this,
which is the logo.
But you said you weren't too bothered about the colours specifically, so long as it was something that kind of worked with that.
Yeah.
If it had been too blue, I felt it was lost on there, which was why I went for the green, because it's got some blue components in it, but we've got the option for the yellow. But do you see how that, depending on which way you look at it, it's red or blue?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's a eureka moment.
It's a blue warp with a red weft.
Yeah, get that.
And when you do that...
That's wonderful.
That is just stunning.
It just kind of... Mm-hmm. And as I turn that round...
You get a different effect.
That's fascinating, what it does to the...
God, it's going to be impossible to film because when you're wearing it. You're going to get moiré patterns everywhere.
Yeah, you will.
What fun.
Because you really do when you...
It's fascinating the way the colour mixes in these greens,
isn't
it?
Glorious.
The greens go... And then the dark greens go quite different.
Yes, and then when this goes over, this is something else again.
A red and
now that one you wouldn't expect to work.
I think the blue is nicer, though, don't you?
Well, my thought was, you see, that we might do that for the bottom half of the
window. Oh, I see, right.
And that for the top
half. That's how I'd read your thing.
I think that's brilliant.
So that's how it was seen.
Oh, right, I didn't realise.
So you don't actually see any of the green on its
raw,
own.
Yes.
But you have...
Put those side by side, you see the effect. Look at
that.
That's terrific.
Isn't that terrific?
So that's the top half of the wing, and that's the bottom half of the wing.
It's funny because those colours are so electric on their own, and yet they're very subtle when you put them together.
Surface colour mixing, here we go.
Glazing. This glazing.
Line, tone and glaze.
The other thing is that I don't feel inclined to try and get totally rid of these creases.
Nope.
The creases are beautiful.
I think the creases actually help with the veining.
Absolutely. They're essential. They look
natural,
wonderful.
Random veining. I was inspired thinking, and you said you just found these when you were going through
over there we keep
bits.
You know, my mother taught me when I started sewing.
Never throw anything away.
Keep it, even the smallest scrap. Now, I've had to actually learn not to keep even the smallest scrap, because I would need Buckingham Palace to house all my scraps if I did that. My inclination when I do the cutting, which we can go and do just now if you want, I have the file set up. My inclination is that I will not concern myself about orientation of the two wings, so that this wing may well look different from that wing as you're looking at it, because on one it might be cut that way and on the other it might be cut that way, which means that one might look more pink than the other, one might look more gold than the other. Is that an issue?
I don't think so, because if you have two wings which are catching light in different ways. When I'm painting the Elphen, one you're looking through the wing and the other one you're looking with the light reflecting on it.
Yeah.
So
and your body is shaped.
I think random is best in this instance, because random gives you the flexibility.
Again, at some point you have to think of the medium.
Yes.
And what the medium does.
The play of light.
And what it is, you know, that it is a textile and you have to go for what the textile does best. I think that's...
Let's go and cut the wings.
Okay.
Oh, right. Wow.
Have I showed you the laser cutter in operation?
No, I'm looking forward to this. We invite you to join me as I share with you my latest illustrated book from Paul Taggart's Elphen Chronicles, Webstrand, the Tooth Gatherer. Fast forward a few years later, and once more, the lure of the Elphen was too great to resist. I began work on another unique collection of masterworks oil paintings, which were to take me well over 5 years to create. As before, the Elphen folklore of Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer took over my life as I worked on these all-important masterworks. The composition for each Elphen portrait and scene-setting painting was originally based on my first draft of the narrative. Soon, however, I found myself changing the interpretation of the story within these paintings, as the world of Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer took hold.
ultimately, the developing paintings had an ever-changing influence on the story. Until both my paintings and story reached a natural conclusion. But this was merely the completion of the first stage. We were now about to embark on the next exciting phase, for the book had to be designed. We had a million ideas to explore. Why not some dedicated elfin music? At the very least, the elfin song, which comes into the story. Our wish list was growing as we added special items. The studio was filling with examples of uniquely produced work by talented craftspeople. What if we filmed the work in progress to share online, so that people could peek behind the scenes at the various creative processes? And how about something else, which is a little bit different, something unique to us? A new concept, something that reflects the work we've been doing online for many years. An illustrated audiobook, maybe. What about something more than that? Welcome to our artist's first edition video storybook. We invite you to listen along with me as I personally read through my unabridged original story. Webstrand, The Tooth Gatherer. Available as a box set containing all 9 chapters for streaming here on Patreon. And so you don't have to pin that down or anything?
I don't have to pin it down because nothing actually touches it other than a beam of light. Now, if we start off with this wing, for the silk, I want to cut those 2 lines, and that will make 1 wing. So it gives me the dimensions of that there, and I just have to set this so that it's going to cut in the right place. I'm just going to set it so that it's silk that it's cutting. It's the little red light.
So it's going around the edge of the...
It's just going just around the edge.
That's quite...
And that's it.
That's it. Wow, that's fast.
There it is. Look it.
My goodness.
1 wing.
Sizzle, sizzle.
It's a nice smell.
Burnt protein.
Wow.
Look at that.
Fantastic.
When you look at that edge, it's sort of...
Basically
sealed the edge.
So
if you were to do it with a synthetic fabric, it would totally melt that edge. So if you see some polyester laces, they've been done this way because the laser actually seals, melts the edge.
That's
1 wing. Do you want to go ahead and do the other wing?
Well, why not?
Why not?
Since we're
go
here?
For it. Absolutely.
So that's the silk cut. Right, blue for the top of the wings.
Wow.
You wouldn't expect something as delicate as this to...
To be able to be cut like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gosh. Look at that.
And I'm deliberately not pressing it.
Yeah.
So there are some wrinkles in it, yes.
Yeah, look at that. You can see it. That's amazing.
This this time we're doing blue, so it's that one and that one, and that will cut this piece. Changing the settings, because it's a much flimsier thing. See how quickly that one's going round?
Because it's only thin material. Wow, that was fast.
Where's your green?
Well, which one is it? This?
This
thing. Oh, I see, right.
No, it must be the other way.
Must be the other one.
Because they are slightly different.
They are different,
well,
yes.
They are, because they're freehand drawn, so they're bound to be different. And not just a duplication of one to the other.
That's
better.
That's the one. That's, yeah, that's it.
So that,
wow,
that works, doesn't it?
And against the blue, we can
so it's all
wow.
There.
Yeah.
Terrific. So. Lovely. It'd be very difficult to get this level of accuracy cutting with freehand, wouldn't it? Almost impossible.
The thing is, any method cutting by freehand, you're going to distort the fabric.
Exactly, yes. Yeah.
So even if you've got a very sharp scalpel, which was how I started.
Yeah, I can imagine.
You know, I did it with a very sharp scalpel. I was changing blades on the scalpel every 10 minutes.
I can imagine. As you said, this has given you so much more scope and flexibility, hasn't it?
Yes, and I find that I can draw straight onto the computer.
Yes.
You know, if the idea's in my head, I'm using a mouse here, but through the computer, which is through the wall layer.
With the stylus.
I'm actually using a graphics tablet. Right, let's take that through and put it down on the table so that we can see it on the navy blue.
Yeah, that's the important thing, isn't it? Wonderful. Wow.
That's basically going to go like that. And that will be positioned so that that bit will be cut off, but it'll be caught in, and that will be.
So it's not straight on; it is actually angular. It's at a diagonal cut. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because I didn't see Sunita's initial sketch, so. As much as anything else, I wanted it to be a surprise for us, you see.
The original sketch.
Oh, is that her
sketch? That's her sketch.
Is that? Really? Oh, wow.
So there's careful positioning has to be done.
Yes, absolutely.
Surprise is over now. I'm looking at Sunita's designs.
So now that will
with
all
that,
just be stitched with
altered.
This dark thread.
Yeah.
So it'll be a satin stitch. This sort of stuff.
Right.
About that sort of thickness.
Width, yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But then there can be single lines, as in these bits.
Yes.
As well.
Yeah.
To make additional textures.
Yes.
And my plan is to do those fine lines of running stitch freehand on the sewing machine.
All right.
Rather than on the embroidery machine.
Right.
Now, there's two reasons for that. One is that it is perfectly possible, particularly because we've deliberately not pressed this fabric, there might be odd bits that haven't caught in on the embroidery machine, which I would have to doctor by hand. If I'm doctoring it by hand as part of adding additional freehand decoration onto it, just means that it will not be exactly as you have painted it in the original.
Oh, no, that's...
I'm going to be using a bit of artistic license.
Yes, absolutely.
It will be
I
feel it needs to go.
Absolutely.
But the important thing about this, Ruth, is that you've caught the random nature of things, and the fact that the veining in the wings is not symmetrical, it's not uniform. It is, I mean, it's not random, because each elfin's wings have different veining patterns.
Mm.
But what you've executed thus far, that's there. So using artistic license is perfectly right.
The only other thing is
the three quills. I'm really pleased with that.
Totally wrong colours, but it was just stitching out.
So that's the patterning.
This is not something that you can easily scale.
Okay.
You know, I can take something that size,
yeah,
and I can reduce it down to that size.
Yes.
But if I want to reduce it down to that size, I have to redigitize it.
Okay.
Which is fine, but this was the size that you sent me in the image.
But the computer can deal with that to that, which
no,
is
interesting. No, no, that's, oh, that's two separate.
Oh, they are two separate.
Two separate files.
Fine.
So, the thing is that you can here you can get the deliberate detail of the slight gaps in the feathering.
Yeah.
Yes.
Whereas here,
it had to be more solid.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's much more solid. Here, I've tried to convey the shape of the inkwell, but I didn't really feel that I got it there. And ignore the colours; it was just what was on the machine.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Well, I think it's interpreted very well, actually.
I think that's
interpreted.
What kind of scale do you want to go to? I don't think anything smaller than that. Sunita's original idea was that it went on the collar.
Yeah.
But the collar, if I find the collar too piece, is too small. But I think it's a shame not. I have got a collar piece.
I do
here.
Like it that size, I must say.
That's a bit big, though.
So. There's your collar piece. So that's what you've got.
Wow, so that's small.
That's tight.
Yes.
It's tight. I can reduce that down a bit, but I'm not sure if you're going to read it.
Mm.
Now, the other thing is we're going to have the runes across there.
We all live in a world of scepticism, disbelief, and doubt. But imagine, if you will, one filled with mystery and magic. Here, wishes can actually come true in a way you would hardly believe. Let me share with you the chronicle of an earthling who goes by the nickname Fizz, whose creative imagination and zest for life leads her on a remarkable journey. A journey which was to change her life forever, on which her guide was none other than Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer. Watch as I depict the story of Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer. Through my scene setting, original Masterworks oil paintings. And the many storytelling illustrations that capture this epic tale. And listen as this chronicle of a wondrous journey is told. Well spotted, Fizz, Webstrand congratulated. Yes, it is an eye gem, but the flash doesn't develop until it's linked to its own special wearer. Owning an eye ring isn't just like wearing a piece of jewellery. It becomes the wearer's companion and can't be used by anyone else. And listen to the original musical soundtrack and soundscape that undulates through the good times and bad, the joy and horrors, the magical and real. If, like Fizz, you also come to believe in Elphen and search carefully along a star's path, you may find what appears to be a small glowing ember in the undergrowth. But be on your guard, for once you start the search, it can soon become a quest.
Just put it there.
Okay,
right, now let's think about this. You've got the border on there. Is that the page border?
Oh, the page border.
She says border. She's written here border.
It's this one.
Oh, on the on there. But we're putting the runes on there, aren't we? No.
No. The runes are on the buttons.
Oh, the runes on the buttons, that's right.
It's the jewelled borders on there, isn't it, Ruth? Little
yes,
border.
Yes, I'll show you the particular one.
But I found these lovely felts. Mm. And I thought, oh, God, I can use these. And I can use them anyway.
That's a delicious palette, isn't it?
But I love the fact that there's different colours in it.
Yeah.
You know, it's not solid. So the idea was we were going to do the borders for this. This was, we were doing it for the slipcover for the book was what we initially thought. But I thought it's worth keeping the same colour palette into here.
Yes, absolutely.
So what's shown as pink there would actually be green.
Green.
So we were going to go for this, where it's this satin stitch, fill stitch, but
padded
with the padding
underneath
of this.
With the padding,
to raise it, yes.
Yes, to raise it up.
Okay.
Yeah.
So one layer of padding that's the whole design, which would be this, and stitched with this. Mm. So even if the felt shows through, we're actually going to like the felt.
Yeah, yeah.
Rather than having it with the grey.
Mm. Yes.
There.
That's it.
It'll enrich the surface rather
and
than.
And then it's a choice.
It's like embossing.
Which would you go for the jewels in it?
I can see it straight away.
You'd go for that one. No, you see, nice. I actually rather liked the blue.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yes, to get the variation.
You could go for either.
I take your point on that, actually.
So you're talking about putting the blue just under the jewels?
Just under the jewels.
All right, yes.
So that they're raised even more.
Yes, no,
and
that's
then you get a variegated result.
So they really stand out.
Actually, that's a good point. Otherwise, it's too samey.
Yeah.
Mm. No, absolutely.
It's like embossing.
Mm-hmm.
That would work.
So we'll go with this, with the bluey.
I can see that.
The bluey one. I wasn't sure. I like both of them.
I know.
And I'm going to use this felt for other things as well, because I like it. Because it's only tiny amounts that we're actually using. Mm.
Yes.
Have a look on the screen and see what you think. It's a bit difficult.
It's a difficult one. This emphasises the yellowness, this emphasises the blueness.
Blue. One concern I have, okay, it just has the slightly deadening effect that metallic thread had.
Because of the blueness?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just think that blue is slightly
It's
not a green blue, is it? It's a slate blue, you see.
Yeah.
That glows. That doesn't glow.
Okay.
Those two contrast very nicely, and in certain circumstances they would work very nicely indeed. But that's slate to gold, whereas this is definitely emerald or jade to gold. Given your jade...
You've convinced me about jade. By saying jade, you've convinced me.
We've got... That's more the colouring in the frontispiece.
Yes.
That's slate.
Mm.
Okay, let's
I
go
think
with this.
So.
That's good. Yeah.
It's the deadening effect.
Mm.
That's just me talking, but...
No, that's fine.
And for both the waistcoat
tell
pocket
you where that,
and for the slipcover.
I'll tell you where that one would work on this series here. You see these?
Yes, whether...
So if we ever do those...
If you ever do those, that's the one.
That's
yeah,
the one.
Yeah.
Isn't
yes,
it?
That's right.
Right.
You're right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because there's nothing to suggest that we mightn't at some point.
Mm-hmm.
So what about this? Because
now, that
I mean,
makes
I love
think.
The detailing on that.
I love the detailing of it at that size, but it's
obviously
it,
just
is
like
there
a little
somewhere
bit
you could use it?
This is about 3 quills, which is yourself, Sunita, and myself. It also stands for art, music, and painting.
Yeah.
So it has a double entendre. If that's that size, it conflicts with Elphen.
It does.
Elphen must dominate on this waistcoat. That's the size for it, but I think it would work above the pocket. I actually think it could work above the pocket.
Just there.
I think it could.
I think what I would like to do, I haven't had time to do it, but I can make that slightly more feathery.
Okay.
You know, not quite as solid.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I think if I make that not quite as solid, but keep it at that size,
and it went to the left of the pocket. In other words, the wearer's left, our right, because I've got the mic there. Yes. There's a good reason for having it on the left.
That's a good reason, actually.
I've got Paul's mic in there.
Mm.
So the motif about there,
as close as you can get to the edge of the pocket on that side, yes. The balanced, that's it.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Mm-hmm. Gold?
So it's not covered.
Gold?
Now, that was the other thing that I was going to say, the colouring of it, because obviously the colours of the image that you sent me was very dark blue, which is not going to be seen against that.
Sunita's played around with this, and she's doing this in various interpretations of it, much like she did with the Elfin logo. She's done metallic versions, she's done inverted versions, she's done a gold version, because I think the gold version is going to be the one on the website. Mm-hmm. So I think if we went for a gold against this.
I was going to say, you could same either, you, I mean, if that's what the stitching on there is going to be, so gold feathers?
Yeah, no, the feathers are always blue.
Oh, but they'll not see them.
Yes, you will.
Well,
because not
a
the
metallic
dark blue.
Blue, or I think it would probably be
that
better
purple
for feathers
side. To actually have a rayon thread.
Okay.
You actually want it to be subtle rather than...
I want it to be subtle.
Yeah.
If the ink pot and the nib are the gold on the border...
I don't like the ink pot. It's a different colour there.
You want the ink pot.
Well, I just think the ink pot, then you see the ink pot more than you see the feathers.
The feathers. Okay, so the feathers...
My inclination would be to say, perhaps stick to rayon threads for this motif rather than... So it could be that the ink pot was that.
That would work. I think that's it.
The feathery bits of the feathers that, but with the actual quill spine of the feather.
Oh, I see what you mean. Oh, that's rather nice, actually, isn't it?
Well, to my mind, what I like about it is that you're actually going from the purple through the blue towards the green, and we're going to have the green jewels.
In there.
On there.
Oh, yeah.
You know, so you're...
That's a nice...
The only thing is, if that's the ink pot, that would actually stick out again. Although it's quite subtle.
You want
subtle.
The ink pot to drop out.
Let me get something a bit more subtle then.
I'll just make it the same colour as the feathers.
No, I was thinking the other way around. Would it work the other way around? Well, that's the...
I see.
Da-da-da.
No, because that blue and that lighter purple don't work together. You can see they don't.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Oh, this is fun. This is what life's about, playing around with colour. Oh, that's
it's
all right.
I know, it is. I just like that colour.
Well, put that back in now. You can take that one out, and those would work.
We couldn't have it that way around.
Yes. Yes, so
those
ink pot, feathers, quill.
Quills, yes.
That's too pink. It doesn't work with those. Immediately you can see it.
That, I think, is nice.
Okay. Fine.
Right.
Not against that, it's beautiful.
That is lovely. And then we don't see enough of the nib on this small size, do we? Of the quill?
No, the nib's in the pot.
Disappear, so that's irrelevant anyway.
It's too small, yes.
So it's just that spine, which I've done in a self colour, the spine would actually be the darker blue.
Yes. Yes.
Which would help. For you to actually read it as feathers.
Yes, because you can see it in the bigger one.
And feel free to make a slightly bigger little cut in it as well.
Yeah.
Right, I'll play around and just see what I can get in the way of cuts.
Yeah, yeah.
I wouldn't object to the bigger three quills going on the back of the slipcase, though.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that would be nice.
Yeah.
Because Quills is the publisher of the book.
Yeah.
So to have the quills on the back of the slipcase...
That would be
that
size, be good.
And then it means we can... I've got ideas for this, you see, for other things.
Mm-hmm.
Lovely.
Love it. Look at that.
Well, that's...
Gosh. I think we've ironed it out, haven't we?
Sorting everything out there. That's wonderful.
Look at all those wonderful colours.
These are fantastic, aren't they? They do.
I'm going to get a pen.
It's a nice palette.
Jot down a couple of notes, just in case I've totally forgotten it.
I think what we should also do is make those five colours our core palette, shouldn't we? So that when we come to do other things, we've got our core palette there.
Okay, so they all link together.
They all link together.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wouldn't have thought those three would go together as well as they do.
I know.
But they do, don't they?
They do, don't they?
I'm just going to make a note of the quotes. Mm-hmm.
So that's the Elphen Quills corporate palette, basically.
So that's just a couple of small scraps so that I can cut out the felt background for there. So I'll go and do that first so that that's ready to go. This bit here gets cut in the gold.
Still going quite a bit of speed there. Oh, look at that.
Look at that. That's extraordinary. It's fun.
Oh, I love my toys, I have to say. I do like my... I do like my toys. So now I'm just going to cut out those two little circles.
These are the jewels, do you?
Yeah.
There you go. Oh my goodness. That's ridiculous. Look at
that. Oh, they're tiny, yeah.
This is one of many free-to-view bonus features, in which we invite you to peek into the process of the various elements that accompany my second book in the Elphen Chronicles. Don't miss out on the magical journey that we're enjoying with Lisa Mulholland, our musical director, as she sets about composing and producing the Elphen soundscape. You will progressively discover that Webstrand the Tooth Gatherer is so much more than just one book, as we share more with you from fellow artists whom we invite to work with us. Welcome to our artist's first edition video storybook, created, filmed, and produced by us in our own studio here in the Highlands of Scotland. We invite you to listen along with me as I personally read through my unabridged original story, Webstrand, the Tooth Gatherer, available as a box set containing all 9 chapters for streaming here on Patreon, accompanied not only by Lisa's evocative music, which wends its way through the entire 9 chapters, but also by my 20 masterworks, and the 116 vignettes, which are brought to life as I read from the pages of this video storybook. In the telling of the wondrous journey and epic tale that is the Elphen folklore, Webstrand, the Tooth Gatherer. This unique concept of our video storybook was inspired by the artistic interpretations of my original story and paintings by our fellow collaborators. Both Sunita, in her captivating book design, and our music director, Lisa Mulholland, in her exclusive compositions, reflect the mood of the story as it unfolds from light beginnings through more challenging times. The swarm kept to the wing, swirling in colours all around her, she realised why. They were calling their farewells. But this was more than a call, it was a song. Although she understood not a word,
Its meanings were unmistakable. It was a song of friendship, of things done together, and of things yet to come. Faster moved the kaleidoscope of colourful wing, and then, on a rush of air, the swarm re-entered the corridor as one. And was gone. Time seemed to retrace its steps. Here was the same fizz as before. Well, perhaps a little changed. Sitting on our bed in the gloom of the same night on which they had left. Welcome to our artist's first edition video storybook. We invite you to listen along with me as I personally read through my unabridged original story, Webstrand, The Tooth Gatherer, available as a box set containing all 9 chapters for streaming here on Patreon.
Oh, what fun. Now we go to another of the machines.
Yeah.
So I'll just step out of the way until the roof's set up.
People have different ideas about whether it's art or not when you use machines.
Oh, that's crazy. Because
that's madness.
Which is crazy, yeah. But as I say, people have different ideas. There's some who think that unless you're actually doing every last bit by hand, it's not art. But I see using the computers and the embroidery machines,
they're tools of the trade,
just in much the same way as using a paintbrush.
Absolutely.
It's just the intermediary device that allows,
your creativity is the thing that's important.
You know, short
not
of
the
doing,
not the
short
tool
of
you.
Doing just finger painting.
It's just, they're just different tools,
aren't
they?
You're using tools.
Mm. Yeah. Absolutely. And you're pushing what they can do all the time, which is what the creative person does. You're not just saying it can just do this, but you're saying, you know, producing these elfin wings, for example. Oh. I mean, that's something where you've got no rule book to go by. You've just got your own sensibilities and your own creativity. And that's the important thing.
Depending on what you're stitching, you use different backings. The aim of these is to support the fabric so that it doesn't pucker with the density of the stitching. So because I'm using silk, which is quite fine, I'm actually having to use quite a thick backing. But this will ultimately be torn away, and the only bits of it that will remain are bits that are behind the embroidery, which you want to be reasonably firm anyway. Now, I have to leave one colour on that is going to provide a good contrast with the navy blue, and that will stitch the outlines and make sure that the placement of the silk is going to be correct. The threading path for this is quite complicated. Okay, that's going to be ready to go, but I now have to just do a final check of the design. The first stitch out is the outlines that are just going to give me placement of the waistcoat pieces.
Yeah.
This is going directly onto that backing fabric.
Right.
And it's just showing me, there's the cut edge of the waistcoat, there's the buttonholes.
Mm-hmm.
And this bit in the middle is the placket for the pocket. That's giving me the outline for stitching that. And then the tack down for stitching that. The satin stitch. And then the jewels. And then the outline for the wings, for the silk. The outline for the organza, the veining, tack down, and then the veining proper. That's the design now gone to the embroidery machine. I'm now setting the colours and putting stop points in. Next thing is just to get it to do a trace. It's to make sure that it is going to fit onto the machine if the frame's got moved or something like that. So this is just mapping out the limits to which it will stitch.
Put another jewel in there, I think. Another jewel?
Yeah.
Another jewel in there.
You'll live with that.
Oh, yeah.
Because I can redo that bit.
No, that's fine. Another jewel in there, I'll be fine.
But it's only when you stitch something out that's when you realise that there is, in fact, that bit missing. So, that's...
Those jewels have worked very well, haven't
they? They're shimmering in the sunshine.
Yeah.
You just have to have, to ensure that there's sunshine whenever you're wearing your waistcoat. So, the next stage is to put on these pieces. We reckon that is the position. It's the button that's roughly at your waist. So, just the outline of the wing.
Now what happened? happens if you get to this stage and you suddenly find, gosh, that's in the wrong place. You can unpick all that.
I can unpick that quite easily.
Can you?
Once you get to that, you know, no, that's a start again. But at this stage, if it's just the outline, it's relatively easy. In fact, I mean, I would take the whole thing off the frame, and underneath, I would actually cut the spool thread. Here.
Yes.
Yes.
You know, I see. A sewing machine.
While it was still on that, right, and just
so, and
pull it off.
And I would snip that because it's easier to get at, and then the top thread would just pull off. But that's looking right because that's going to give us the overlap in the right place. Just watching out for this thread. I'm happy with that placement. I think, you know, it's giving a nice
balance to it.
Yes, balance without symmetry.
Yeah.
Off centre. This is the point at which one must not allow oneself to be distracted. That is that wing. And that's that one. This is where the laser cutter really comes into its own, because that precision of cutting would be very difficult to achieve. Obviously with fabrics, some fabrics more than others, the fabric kind of has a degree of flexibility in it, but you'll see odd little bits where it's not quite matching up with the outline. That should still be okay for being covered with the... Now,
because of the width of the...
Yeah, it's now just going to stitch a line for us to position the top shading for the wing and the bottom shading.
You really have to think about the layers here, don't you?
Yeah. Getting the sequence right is quite important.
Yeah.
And programming in the stops so that it knows that after it's stitched that colour. It's going to stop in the right place for the next one. Right.
So my heart would be in my mouth now if I were doing what you were doing now. Wow.
So, I'm going to position all the pieces just so that I know that they are fitting in the right place. There. And that one is going to go there. Okay, so. Right. That's one side.
Excellent.
What's happened here is that because the cut has gone on the bias of the organza, that bit has stretched long ways. I've got to kind of pull it up.
Just pull it around, yes. But as we were discussing earlier, it doesn't really matter if it kinks a little bit in places. It's part of the...
It's part of the attraction nature, of it. We want it to look quite
wonderful,
ethereal. Right.
Gosh.
Now I'm just going to take a bit of this. If I'm working with Harris Tweed, I usually press this at this stage.
Mm-hmm.
But for this,
just rubbing it down.
All I'm wanting to do is rub it down, just to be
so
absolutely
fine.
Certain that it's all caught in place. But you need something covering it. Otherwise your fingers would catch in the edges of the fabric.
You know, that shouldn't work, but it does.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Now, I just want to see how this thread behaves. I'm just going to keep an eye on this. That in okay.
Well, that colour's perfect, isn't it? The colour for that thread is perfect.
Now, on here, you can actually see what it's doing.
Oh, right.
When I'm through next door at the computer there, which is just linked to this one, so that I don't need to stand and listen to the noise all the time, I can watch the progress of it. And if it runs out of bobbin thread or breaks a top thread or something like that, it'll flash up an alarm telling me that it's doing it. And it's telling me that we've got 44 minutes left for this to stitch out.
Wow.
So I don't know if you want to film 44 minutes of it or if you just want to
take it in sections.
So at the moment it's just doing the zigzag, the open zigzag catch down on the acoustic fabric. So it looks very pink from here. And then when you come and look at it.
I can see it changing. Yeah, absolutely.
But I love the fact that we've got these variations in the colour, that it's not just a flat. I mean, it would have been very easy just to say, oh, that green silk goes, and just put a piece of green silk down, and oh, that yellow silk goes, and just put a piece of yellow silk down. But I think having that, the hand-dyed silk,
it's amazing. It looks so different when you get the brown outline.
And what I did for the silk, for dyeing the silk, was I basically just wet the silk and I crumpled it up and I sprinkled dry dye powder over it,
so it
and then sprayed
it.
A bit more water onto it.
All right.
And then I shoved it in the microwave.
Oh, wow. It's strange because you put the lab guns on top, the wings look transparent. It's really strange.
Yeah. Yes, because I think what you're seeing is that you're almost interpreting as though there's
the
behind it.
Yeah.
And it looks as though it's show you that here. I have to do that at home because this sewing machine doesn't like the tallow thread.